naturally come up to be of patients with the same category of the disease. And, you know, try based on that, people can, experts can also make some inferences and treat better. So all these are different applications driven by unsupervised learning. That is why it is very important to study unsupervised learning also. We do have a lot of techniques already, not a whole lot of them, but we do have literature developed. For example, if you ask me the major techniques in unsupervised learning, clustering and dimensionality reduction and density modeling, these are typically what. There was a question. Let me quickly see. Yes. So web scraping, yes, that is also possible to understand the behavior and suggest also. Correct. Yeah. Maybe there are also these days involved machine learning tools. I'm not really sure, although. All right, let's get back. So these are some of the major techniques or tools in unsupervised learning. I'll try to introduce to you briefly because, you know, understanding them is very important. And yeah, you will see why. All right. So let's see first clustering, what clustering is. Some of you may already know, but try to understand it from, you know, in a comparison with supervised and also, you know, I don't have any hands-on, but I strongly recommend, you know, trying to do some hands-on immediately so that you will see how you can relate in your own, you know, research problems or, you know, when it comes to solving a challenge or technique. So these things can be used or borrowed if necessary. All right. So first, let's see what clustering is. So clustering, as we can understand from the title itself, it's about finding subgroups in the data. They are called clusters. If there is any similarity within the data samples, they naturally form cluster by coming closer in some sense, right? And what is clustering? It is basically partitioning data into different groups. When we do that, the distinct groups that we create will have similar data. Within one particular cluster, the data samples will be very similar. But when you look at data from different clusters, it should be dissimilar. Right? That is what we mean by clustering, finding the subgroups by partitioning the data. And within each clusters, the similarity of the data should be high. And across the clusters, the similarity should be small. They should be different. So what do we mean by similar or different? Of course, it is data specific. It depends on the domain the data is coming from, right? For example, in a breast cancer data, for example, if you take, this is a good example. So consider data of breast cancer patients. The data would be generally the size of tumor, stage in which it is diagnosed, and gene expression of the patient, and, you know, age, and all other medical measurements and things like that. That will be the features. Based on that, you can cluster, right? You can cluster and see if at all there is a, if we cluster, you can see if there is a subgroup of breast cancer patients which have a specific type of breast cancer, right? So is there any similarity? Is there any pattern in occurrence of this disease, right? Whether there is any geographic region that is affected by breast cancer, some type of a breast cancer, or any other age group specifically that is getting affected because of one of these types of breast cancer and all that. So this is all possible with clustering. And what is similar, what is dissimilar, how to define this is problem specific. So based on the features being used and the nature of the problem, these things will be decided. And clustering may find sometimes, it may be able to, because that is what the structure means, right? So if at all there is any naturally occurring clusters in the data, we should be able to find them and analyze them. So let us take up one particular example algorithm, which is K-means. There are multiple other, like hierarchical, agglomerative, and all those things are there. But anyway, they are not very different. Let's try to understand one briefly. The K-means clustering is very familiar to all of us, and maybe most of us. And what it does exactly is, it is very simple and elegant. And it is also very intuitive. We can understand why I say that. So it is very simple and elegant for clustering into K non-overlapping groups or clusters. The K here is user-specific. The user, whoever is using the algorithm, has to specify what is the number K, how many clusters you want to the data to be partitioned into. So we need to specify that. That's kind of a limitation. We'll get back to that. And once you give that, the algorithm will assign each observation to exactly one cluster. So let us say there are n data points. And you said K is equal to 10. You want to see 10 groups, 10 clusters in the data. So everything will be assigned to exactly one cluster at the end. So this is an example. So there is a data, synthetic data. This is not a natural data, 2D data plotted in XY plane like this. And if I want two clusters, so you can see easily you can see this is one cluster and this is another cluster. So maybe this is natural choice to give K is equal to 2 and find out the two clusters. What if we give K is equal to 3 for the same data? So you have this cluster unchanged, but there are subgroups within this big cluster, like one dense region here, another dense region here. So that's why K is equal to 3 gives you these three clusters. Each cluster is specifically shown in a different color. The green here, gold color here, and blue color here. What if K is equal to 4? Again, it seems like this cluster is unchanged. Within this big cluster only, algorithm found three different small clusters. This one and this one is already there. And here, these regions, part of the green cluster also has become the fourth cluster. Right. So these are just examples. I wanted to show you how the algorithm finds out the clusters. Clusters means, the points that are being tied closely together. Yeah. So let's see how intuitively this algorithm happens, how the structures of the data can be found. The patterns and things that make the features to be closer. We'll see how it is. So let's have some notation. Let's say n is the number of data points, small n, and p is the dimensions, the number of features in each data point, right? It's very likely that we will have high dimensional data. For example, take the breast cancer example. The vector belonging to one person, which is called the data sample or feature vector, it will contain a lot of information. P is just the dimension of the space, right? I'm talking about that only. In case of breast cancer example, what do you collect from the patient? Age, marital status, maybe other medical conditions. You take all other medical measurements, starting from BP, sugar, and if you do any blood tests and all those things, and whatever diagnosis you do generally. So all those information put together will form a vector. Let's say 15 values you measure. So P becomes 15 in that case. So that is P. And N is basically you did these measurements for 100 cancer patients. N becomes 100. Right. Now you want to cluster this 100 data points, which are 15 dimensional in nature. So clusters, let us say K clusters, I want to name them C1, C2, and so on, CK. So what is the objective? All the points, 1 to N, 100 points, should be assigned to at least one cluster. There should not be any point left, right? If you see here, all the points are clustered. This is in blue cluster, this is in gold, and similarly, there is no point left out, right? All the points are clustered. So this condition is that only. If you take the union of all these clusters, it should be equal to the whole points, 1 to 100. And intersection should be 5. That means no two clusters should share the points. Exactly one cluster should be assigned to every point. For example, you see, all the dots have only one color. There are no two colors for a single dot. That means each point belongs to exactly one cluster, not more. So this is the basic criterion. You will have all the points assigned label, and no point should be left out. No point should be shared between the clusters. All right. So let us intuitively think. So we want to cluster, we want to find out the groups that are there in the data. How do we think? Basically, what do we want? Within each cluster, the variation should be very small. They should be very, very close. Only then we say, okay, this forms a group. So when we say that, within the cluster, if the variation is very small, then we'll say it is a good clustering, right? Yeah, so that is the idea. Amount by which the samples within a group differ has to be minimal, right? It should not vary from each other much. Only then you will say all of them looking similar, all of them form a group, right? That is the criterion. So how do we put that into math? How do we make into an equation? Let us define within cluster variance. W of CK means what it does is it will go to CK, try to see the points and try to find out how they are varying, how much they are dissimilar. And because there are K clusters, you will try to sum all those variations, within cluster variations. And we need to minimize that, right? That is when we say the clusters are very similar. Within the cluster, the data is very, very similar, very close. So how do we actually compute the within cluster variation? There can be many choices. For example, it depends on the features, it depends upon the domain area and all. But most often we use Euclidean distance, right? Because these are points. If they are similar, they will be Euclidean sense, they'll be very close to each other, right? So the distance can be one metric. If there is not much distance between these samples within the group, it is a big, good cluster. On the other side, if the interpoint distance, the distance between pairs of points is very large, it will not be convincing to say they form a cluster, right? It is not a good cluster. So for a good cluster, what should be minimum? The within cluster variation should be minimum. Within a cluster, there should be very close, very similar. So this is what people use typically, Euclidean distance between any pair of points within CK. So there are K such things, so you need to do for all such case. So this is only for one K, right? What is happening is you take a pair of points, I and I prime, and you have to find the distance between those two. Because these are vectors, you are taking, P components are there in two vectors. Euclidean distance between two vectors is basically, summation between x1 minus x2, all the components between the points. So this is what is happening. It's a simple distance between vectors. Because there are different pairs, you are taking all such pairwise distances. And this is, cardinality. What is the number of points within the cluster? So that it is kind of averaging. On an average, what is the distance between the points? So this we want to minimize. So the objective of the K-means clustering becomes like this. So there are K clusters. You want clusters that have within cluster variation minimum as possible. All right. So this becomes the ultimate objective one solves in K-means clustering. Right. I hope I brought the intuition. Basically, the intuition is we want to cluster the data into groups. What is a good cluster? Where the distance between the cluster points is minimum. All that is happening is we are finding such clusters where the distance between the points is minimum. All right. So this is not an easy problem. Although it looks like very intuitive and very easy to understand, it is a very difficult problem to solve because there are K labels and N points, right? Each of them there will be K raised to N possible clusterings, right? So each of the point can be assigned to any of the K. So it will have K options. And second point also will have K options. Third point will also have K options and so on. K into K into K into K n times. In total, K raised to n possible clusterings are possible, out of which we want one minimum, one that minimizes this thing. That is why it is a very difficult problem. But what we do is, instead of solving it exactly, we'll go for a greedy approach. It will give only local optimum, not global optimum. So global optimum means one point where the value of this objective is the minimum, the least value obtained by this one is called global minimum. Because it is very difficult to solve, what we solve is for local minimum. What do we mean by local minimum? Imagine a you shift the optimization paths where, you know, global minimum means the lowest trough. But because of the difficulty, we may not go there. So we go to another possible minima where it is locally minimum, but it is not as minimum as the global minimum. But it is okay to work. That is what is happening in k-means clustering also. So what we do, how we run the algorithm is simple. Randomly assign a number from 1 to k to each of the observations. So you have small n data, and randomly initialize for each point, you assign one of the labels. So you will have initial labels assigned. And then in the second step, what we should do is, now there are labels. So for each of these labels, you can find out the centroid. Centroid means, you know, the mean of the points that are belonging to one cluster. So now you have centroids. Based on the centroids, you reshuffle the labels. You reiterate the algorithm to change the labels. So all the points that are close to one particular centroid, you assign that label, right? Although you completed the cluster centroid from the random assignment, because now you are assigning the labels based on the cluster centroids, it will change. For example, take this example. So this is the first step. I am given data. I don't have any labels. I want to cluster into three clusters. K is equal to three. What I'll do is I randomly assign labels. You can see here, I am randomly assigning purple color, gold color, and green color. Randomly I assigned. Now I am computing the cluster centroids. For orange, the cluster centroid is here. And for purple, it's also very close, but a little, you know, towards down left. And green is also bottom right, slightly bottom right, although they're very, very close. Why this happened? Because we randomly assigned all over the place, you know, all the three colors are spread. That is why towards the middle point, the centroids will come. But there will be slight difference because, you know, there will be not equal number of points and colors, right? That is why a small difference is there. Now, whatever point that is closest to the orange, you assign orange. And all the points that are close to purple, you assign purple. Now you trust these things more. Although they are coming from the labels, random labels, you are giving more importance to these ones. And now you are changing the labels again. So this is how it looks. In the fourth step, because you are assigning for all these points, orange is close by. That is why the label of all these points becomes orange. And this set of points are very close to purple, not to orange, not to green. That is why all the label of these points becomes purple. Similarly, bottom right also. These set of points are close to green centroid than the orange one and purple one. That is why they change the label to green. Yes. Now, you just alternate between these two steps. Now you have new labels in the data. So these centroids also change. Centroid means, you know, mean of all the green points, mean of all the purple points, mean of all the gold or orange color points. Because orange is spread only in this region, the mean will be here. Here also, purple centroid will be here and green centroid will be here. Now the means are changed. Now the labeling also changes. How do we label? Whatever point that is closer to orange, we'll assume orange label. Anyway, these are all already orange labeled. So there will be only slight changes. For example, if you see here, these two points were orange earlier, but now the green centroid is more closer to these points than orange. That's why they change the label to green. So after some iterations, there will not be any more changes in the labels. That is when you say the k-means clustering algorithm is saturated and you return the labels there. So it is naturally finding the clusters. If you see, this is where we started. You know, visually also we can say there is one group of points here, one group of points here, and another group of points here, right? So that is what we ended up finally, right? So this is what the k-means does, naturally finding out. Yes, Balabandha, you may go ahead. Do you have a question?
Sir, I will type my question in chat box, sir.
So okay, go ahead.
What is your first
So this is what happens. So now let us go back to the algorithm. So it is only three steps algorithm. Even if you want to implement, there are libraries which can do this for us. But anyway, so you can simply try to implement in three steps like this. Randomly assign, and once you have the labels, try to compute the cluster centroids, which are means of all the points that assume a single cluster. And once you have the new cluster centroids, you need to update the labels. How? Take the point, whichever centroid is closer to that point, you assign that label. Let us say green is closer to this point, that particular point assumes green label. So you have to visit all the points and see which centroid is closer to that point. So based on that, you change the label. Because the labels have changed now, you have to go back and update the centroids also. Centroid is again mean of all the points belonging to one color. You just assign a centroid for that. Similarly, you just do this iterations sometimes, and you will see you will hit a point where there is no more change in the color. So that is where you stop. And I don't want to get into the math, but it is easy to see why it is guaranteed to reduce the objective. And I just gave you the equations. It is very easy to follow. You can follow offline also. All right. So the results typically depend on the initial random clustering, right? Because you are initially, what you are doing is randomly assigning, and then based on that, you are going to compute the centroids. So it is dependent on the random assignment of the labels. Typically, that is why the algorithm is run multiple times, let us say 10 times or 20 times, and then whichever labeling assigns, whichever label results in a minimum within cluster variation, right? We can compute the within cluster variation. What is that? The sum of all the interclass distances, right? Sorry, interclass distances. All the pairs of points within a class, you compute the distance, and whichever clustering minimizes that distance, we will go with that. For example, let us say I ran six times the clustering algorithm, k-means clustering algorithm on this data. Right, the question is how do we actually assign random things? So let us say these are the points. Let me go back. So this is the data given, right? I want to assign randomly. So just, think of a very intuitive process. So the number of clusters is expected to be three, because I am choosing k is equal to three. That is a drawback of k-means clustering, but let me get back to that later. So let us say you want to assign three labels randomly to this data. So I'm just giving an example. Perform an experiment with three outcomes, right? Let us say picking a random number between 0 to 1, right? It can be anything between 0 to 1. So the first event is 0 to 0.33. Second event is 0.33 to 0.67. And third event is 0.67 to 1, right? Imagine an experiment with three outcomes. For example, tossing a coin will have only two experiments, right? If it is assigning two random colors, what I can do is I'll flip a coin. If heads, I'll assign blue color. If tail, I'll assign a black color or red color, something like that, right? So that is what is probabilistically assigning random values. Because now we have three colors, what I do is I'll create an experiment where the outcomes are three, right? If you pick randomly a number between 0 and 1, and first event is between 0 to 33, and 33 to 67, 67 to 1, they are all equiprobable three different events, right? Every time the number, if it is between the 0 to 33 gap, I'll assign gold color, right? Now I'll go to another point, I'll pick another number. If it is 0.79, because it is falling in the third range, I'll assign a green color. Next time I'll go to another point, right? I'll pick another random number between 0 to 1. It is falling in 0.5. It is falling in the second group. The outcome is the second. So I'll assign a purple color. I'll do this at every point. I'll do this experiment. Based on the result, I'll assign a color. So this is randomly assigning a color, right? You will choose a random experiment with that many outcomes. So typically this happens, you know, like I said, a random number is generated. If it is five values, you have to make the ranges 0 to 0.2, 0.2 to 0.4, 0.4 to 0.6, 0.6 to 0.8, 0.8 to 1. Randomly pick a number based on the range, you pick the color and assign that to that point. Right? So I hope it's clear. Yeah. So if it is 2, it is very easy with 0.5 probability, right? Flipping a coin, heads this color, tails that color. So this is how it is decided. In computer, you cannot do all these things. So what you do is simply pick a random number between 0 to 1. If it is below 0.5, assign red. If it is above 0.5, assign blue. Things like that. All right. So as we said, performance of k-means clustering depends on the initial assignment of the labels. So what we do is we perform the experiment multiple times. Here in this slide, 6 times the experiment is performed. And every time at the end of the experiment, end of the algorithm, we will compute what is the sum of within class variations, within cluster variation. So this is 320.9 for first experiment, 235.8 and so on. We have to pick the one with minimal variation, right? Just give me a second. All right. So of all these experiments, I have to pick the one with minimal within cluster variation. That is 235.8, yeah. So any of them is equally good. This one, this one, or this one, this one. So even in the libraries, for example, in scikit-learn, PyTorch, lot of libraries are there where you can use k-means clustering directly. You don't need to code the whole algorithm. It is already implemented. So when you do that, by default, they run for, let's say, 50 such experiments. And whatever is the experiment that has minimal within cluster variation, that result will be output, right? So as I was saying, the drawback of k-means clustering is, you know, you need to give k. Sometimes it is easy, sometimes it may not be easy. Where you have some information about the data, it may be possible for us to give, you know, the k value that is appropriate. For example, you know, if it is the data collected over multiple seasons, we have hardly 3 seasons, right? Winter, the rainy season and summer. So if we have some information that is related to the data, then you can come up with a useful k. Otherwise, it is very difficult to come up with an appropriate k. If you use more, a bigger value of k, the clusters will be split, right? If you use smaller values of k, unnecessarily the different data also will be clustered. So that way it is dependent or sensitive to the value of k. But there are clustering algorithms that are a little more intelligent, like agglomerative clustering, where you start from, it's like a dendrogram, where basically, you know, you start with the clustering 2 points if they are similar, and go slowly on building on top of 2 points, 4 points, and so on. It's like a tree, inverted tree, you can think of that. Yeah. So there are better ways of clustering. I just wanted to give you an idea how we can learn from data without having the labels. So what we learned here, we learned the structure. We kind of, you know, separated the data into groups. Now we may do further analysis, what sort of similarity is there in this data and all that. This is kind of a first step, right? So this is one task we can do without labels, unsupervised learning. All right. So this is a very nice illustration. I took it from doersdatascience.com. So they showed it, how the clustering happens. If this is the data, and if k is equal to 2, k means does this kind of a clustering. This is not very useful because, this is a better clustering. All the points that are there in this manifold, one label, and all these points that are labeled on this manifold, one label. This is a better clustering, obviously. And here also, because the distance takes a very significant weight in k-means clustering, this half circle is purple and the next half circle is the cyan, right? But maybe this is a better clustering. All the points that are in the inner circle is one cluster, and the outer circle is another cluster. Yeah, based on different criterion used for clustering, there may be different outputs of clustering, right? Here it's same, three different clusters, because it is pretty clear. The data is very well separated, and there are no patterns like, you know, concentric circles or anything like this. So things are easy here. All right, so that's about clustering. One of the major unsupervised learning problems. And dimensionality reduction is another unsupervised problem. Okay, 35 minutes, right. So dimensionality reduction using PCA is another very, very powerful, very useful technique in unsupervised learning. So I'll try to briefly again give you an idea what it is and what we learn in unsupervised way of PCA. Yeah. So what is PCA? It refers to the process of computing principal components and use them for understanding the data. So what are principal components and how do we use them to understand data? We will see. So principal components basically mean, yeah, again, let us say you want to visualize n data points, each of them with p features or p dimensions, right? So whatever data we were talking about, for example, you know, the data collected from breast cancer patients, which is of 15 dimensions, right? So all the data, like at what stage it is diagnosed, what is the size of the tumor and all that, right? So you want to visualize the data. Because there are 15 features, we cannot put the data in 15 dimensions and visualize it, right? We have to see either 2D or 3D. At the max 3D we can visualize. But there are, let's say, 15 features. So if P features are there, PC2, it will be P into P minus 1 by 2. Number of 2D scatter plots will be 2. Right? Every time, you know, you pick two features and then put them on the 2D plane and see. It is not practical, right? Because, you know, with P is equal to 10 itself, it goes to 45, right? So it's really difficult to visualize, you know, 45 two-dimensional scatter plots and then understand. So we need a better technique. We cannot visualize if it is high dimensions, right? So this is where we need a low-dimensional representation of the data that captures as much information, as much variety as possible without disturbing the structure of the data. We want to bring that from high dimensions to low dimensions onto a screen where we can see. 2D is where we can comfortably see and analyze. So we need such visualization technique. So that dimensionality reduction technique, which brings the data from high dimensions to 2D comfortably. So this is the catch. As much information as possible, that has to be captured, right? So let us see if it is possible. Right. So what PCA does is it finds a low dimensional representation of the data that contains as much variety as possible, which was there in the original data. So the variety in the data comes out of natural process. Whatever the process that is being generated, that is generating the data, will give you the natural variation. We need to retain that. So PCA does that to some extent. What is the idea here? Each sample lies in a p-dimensional space. But not all these individual features are equally important, equally interesting. Some of them may not really add useful data. For example, so this is what happens. So let me just, you know, give you briefly what happens generally. So although the data in principle has 15 dimensions, it may not require that many dimensions to represent the data. Although, you know, there are quantities we are measuring that are 15 different things, maybe they are related. There is a relation between some of the data features which are redundant. It is most commonly observed in almost all the data this happens. Because of the correlations that exist between these features, you don't need to record all the 15 of them. Only a combination of some of these features is good enough. So that is what we are exploring, right? Not all the P dimensions are equally important, equally powerful, equally interesting for us to analyze. So that is what we are exploring. Now the challenge is how to find what are interesting, how to find those, you know, combinations of those features which are small in number, which can do the visualization and analysis process. So that is all about PCA. It finds smaller number of dimensions that are as interesting as possible. So let us say this X1 to XP, this is the data in 15 dimensions, P dimensions, P is 15. So now I want to project all of it into the first two, very one important dimension. So I call it Z1, where I'm projecting all these 15, which is a linear combination. I'm taking all the 15 and taking a linear combination of them. Right, I'll talk about that, how to actually process the low dimensional data and get the accuracy, correct? Yes, yes, very good accuracy, because it retains, we are finding the low dimensional data, which is not compromising on the variety in the data, right? It is preserving the data's variety, variation in the data. So if it is collapsing the variation, we, in the end, all the data points look same if it is collapsing. If all the data look similar, it is difficult to classify. It is difficult to discriminate. So we don't do that. We will try to preserve as much variation as possible. I'll show how the objective is constructed in PCA. So let us say I want to find the first dimension where the data is maximally separated, like the variation within the data is clearly retained. So what I do is I'll take a linear combination of the data, which is 511 into X1, 521 into X2, and so on. Because the data is P dimensions, I'll have that many coefficients, all right? So each of these new dimensions are linear combinations of the old data. Now what we do is, these 51 to 5p are referred to as loadings of the first principal component. This is, you know, legacy terms. You can think of it's a transformation. The vector 51 to 5p is being applied on the data x1 to xp, the p dimensional data. Now think of a matrix dot product between the 51 and x. So that is what is happening. Now, what is my criterion? I want to maximize the variation in Z1, right? Yeah, the principal component is the vector formed out of 511, 521, and so on, 5p1. So this is principal component. I am projecting the data X onto this principal component. The dot product, the result of that is shown here, 511 into X1 and so on. The output is called Z1. This is the after projecting X1 to XP, this is the first component. If I want only one-dimensional representation of this vector X1 to XP, this is already here. This is the one-dimensional representation. I can have two dimensions because I can visualize in 2D. If at all visualization is my primary objective, I'll do, this is the first component. You can think of as X, and I'll find out Z2 also, which will be Y, and then I'll project in this Z1 and Z2 plane, right? So that is how I'll project the p-dimensional data into two dimensions. So this is the first dimension. So how to find out this dimension? What was the objective? I want to retain the variety, the variation in the data as much as possible. Let us see how to do that. So how do we compute? So look for the linear combination that has the highest variance. So this is the, so my first point is xi 1 all the way to xi p, right? This is my ith point. Because it is vector of p dimensions, the second coordinate is representing the dimension. But it is only the ith point, ith x. When I applied on the first principal component, I'll get the corresponding new dimension, the first dimension. So what I want to do is, I want to maximize the variety. So this Zi1 for all the points should be maximized, right? Variation in that across the point should be more. So there are n points, I is equal to 1 to n. This is what my Zi1 is. So this is the linear combination. So this is expressed as j is equal to 1 to p, phi j I, x I j. So I'm just representing this particular equation here. Because what was the objective? The variation in the components should be maximum. So this I am, so if you go more into the details, you know, we have to mean subtract it to zero, and then because variation or variance, if you talk more mathematically, the variance is sigma x minus x bar squared, right? X bar anyway is zero because we are starting with mean separated data. So this is basically the variance. This is how the objective is realized. We are maximizing the variance in the new dimensions. If you don't do that, you know, you will collapse the data. It will not be very useful. You can't even perform discrimination between the among the data. I'll show an example. I think that will be very clear. So this, let us say I am given only two-dimensional data. So forget about 15 because it is difficult to imagine. Let us work with only two dimensions. So from two dimensions, we can come to one dimension. That is dimensional tree reduction from 2D to 1D, right? So just forget about the green and blue line. If this is the data given, so if I want to reduce the dimension, I want to represent them using only one dimension. So now currently, how to represent these purple points? Because it is in 2D, two coordinates are required. For example, if you look at this point, it is 20, maybe 2 or 3, right? 20 here, x-axis, 3 in the y-axis, 20, 3. This also maybe 15, 4, things like that, like 16, 4. So all these points require two dimensions. Now I want to reduce the dimension to only one. So what I do? But when we reduce the dimension, we should be able to discriminate, right? Now we can discriminate easily. All the points have two different x coordinate and y coordinate. So it is easy to differentiate this point versus this point, or for example, this point versus this point. Now, if I want to reduce the dimension and still want to be able to separate them, what to do is you need to find out the direction in which there is maximum variation. So if you see the green direction, if you project all the data points onto this, project means, you know, dropping onto this perpendicularly. So try to follow my cursor. So if I project this onto the x-axis, the green axis, it is just, you know, falling onto this. So imagine now, you know, clubbing the data onto the green axis. You will have data lying on these green points, right? The spread, the horizontal spread is more there. That is why we say that direction, green direction, is preserving the variation in the data. As opposed to, for example, take the blue line. If you just project everything onto blue line, again, projecting means dropping perpendicularly like this, and here dropping perpendicularly onto this. So all of the data is just falling on only this much length, right? There is not much variety, correct? Imagine in the first case, the data is falling on from here to here. There is a lot of variety, right? The component that is used for representing the data will be, let us say, minus 10 to plus 10. But here it is only minus 4 to plus 4. The variety is reduced, right? So principal components is finding out this direction. So this is the first principal component. And then projecting onto that will give you one coordinate. From 2D, you come to 1D. So in higher dimensions, there will be more than one, more than two principal components. So you have to choose those many principal components where your variety is preserved up to 95% or 96%. What is the need? What is the need? First, so this is the need. Let us say you want to visualize n samples of data with p features. So you have to create 2D scatter plots. Visualization is very, very important and very powerful also. We have to visualize. Only then we will understand what patterns are there, and we can motivate the machine learning to solve those problems. Every problem starts with visualization. We have to visualize. It is difficult. I know it is very, very difficult to visualize high dimensional data, but still, visualization helps. Reduce the dimension and try to visualize in lower dimensions, right? So all this is very, very important. And also, not only visualization, PCA is important to find out these uncorrelated. Let me just go back to that. Yeah. Now the new coordinates, the green line and the blue line, are uncorrelated because they are perpendicular, right? So you can reduce the dimension and you can use very powerful uncorrelated features. For example, take this breast cancer example. Whatever features you collect from the patient, like the age, all the medical measurements, whatever you take from the patient, all of them, they are not uncorrelated. We cannot guarantee them. There may be common information across these things, right? Same information can be measured from three. Right, data loss means the variation loss. Correct. So let me repeat, let me just continue. So the data collected from these patients need not be uncorrelated, right? So the same information will be captured in multiple information. The same, like for example, blood test and some other tests will also represent the same common underlying behavior, underlying state of the body, for example. So in PCA, that will be avoided. Whatever dimensions you will find out will capture very orthogonal information. What is captured by green will not be captured by blue. So that way, although the dimensions are reduced, the information contained will be more, right? Per dimension, it is more compared to the original space P. All right, so there was one question. Let me just get back to that. What is data? Will data lost? Yes, data will be lost, but only minimal. But the gain in terms of dimensions, dimensionality reduction is very, very valuable. And because of that only, we go for it. For example, I will be able to retain 99% of the structure, but I may reduce the dimensions by half. Right? If I reduce the dimensions by half, my computations will be faster. And I also can do a lot of better visualization, better analysis. Things get a lot easier in lower dimensions. And some of the techniques we developed work only in lower dimensions. The approximations will be meaningful in lower dimensions. In higher dimensions, whatever approximations we do will be erroneous. So our tools and techniques may not work in higher dimensions. That is why, if it is possible, always come down to low dimensions and perform. So this is a general principle. Whenever you do machine learning, if it is allowed, the problem is comfortable to come down to lower dimensions, please do that. That's the first step. Right, and then you apply whatever techniques you want to apply. So that way, data loss is there, but very minimal. It gives us better, advantages, other advantages. So that is why we do. So this is all unsupervised learning. There is no label being used. All that we are finding is, so this is what the data is given. Now I'm finding out, other space where if I project it will be better representation of the data. So all that. For example, after I projecting, if it is a classification data, I'll simply give a threshold of zero. Everything above zero is one class and below zero is one class, right? So because now that the dimension is preserving variance, the variety in the data is preserved, I can use it for discriminating the data also. So a lot of such applications are built on PCA, right? So regression performed on these dimensions is shown better, if not less, to performing regression on the normal data, normal dimensions. So all these are unsupervised again, right? So these are some of the very familiar, this is a pretty old topic, but even today it has very strong applications. All right, so I believe I have convinced you PCA is another unsupervised technique. So there is some math I am skipping, which is some parts are very much out of the scope, but anyway, so the idea is this: given the data, you will find out the dimensions in which the variety is preserved, and you can find more and more orthogonal directions where the information captured earlier will not be correlated, will not be there in the new ones, so that every time you add new dimension, new information altogether is contained. All right, so those are two important techniques in unsupervised learning. So density modeling is another unsupervised technique. So density modeling is a little complicated. I'll try to give you the overview or broad picture. Let us see. So let's get back to the problem where unsupervised means you will be only given data, no labels will be there. Right. So how to find out the data without losing, how to find out the dimensions without losing much of the data? That's a good question. So every time we project, we will have a coefficient associated with that also. So which is this one. So this one, sigma is equal to 1 tn zi squared. Just excuse me, really sorry about that. I'm really sorry about that. Yeah. So it is possible. So it is there, in fact, how to decide on how many data dimensions, how many dimensions we need to go back. It is a little difficult to explain very briefly, but I'll try to give you a broad idea how we go about it. So this quantity characterizes the energy captured by Z1 in the new space, right? If you just go on doing it, summing the first component's contribution, second component's contribution, so you can think of a CDF, right? Cumulative distribution. So first captures 65%, and then from there 20% is captured by second dimension and third. So this is it's possible to mathematically count. How do we go to full screen? So this quantity Zi1 squared. So this is the relative contribution of the first feature, right? So there will be p at the max or n components, right? If there are p dimensions, you cannot have more than p dimensions in the new space, right? The new dimensions will be not more than p or n. So if you just take the contribution, which is, you know, Zi squared by summation of all Zi squared will give you the energy contributed by the first component. And if you do the same for the second, it will give the second and so on. So you can retain so many components where the percentage is 90, generally it is 95%. So let us say three or four components are good enough. Taking summation of Z1 squared plus Z2 squared plus Z2, Z3, 4, Z3 squared and Z4 squared divided by the rest of all will give you the contribution, how much is retained, how much is lost in the energy sense, right? You can think of the data as signal and how much is reconstructed properly, how much is lost. So that is possible. And based on that, you will choose how many dimensions to retain also in all the machine learning problems. All right. Yeah, because it's a little time taking, I'm skipping. But so this eigen analysis, eigen decomposition will give you all those details. Yeah. All right. So the third important application in unsupervised learning is density modeling. Basically, what it means is you know data, only data is given. So can we learn the data itself? So no targets are given. So what I want to do is likelihood of data, the probability for this data. For example, think of a real data collected from a cancer patient. So all the 15 dimensional data is real. The probability for that is high because it is actually happened, right? Compare a randomly written 15 dimensional data. I don't know what it is. I'm just randomly writing a 15 dimensional data and I give it to you. The probability for that will be very small. That cannot occur, right? Because it did not happen, right? So that is knowing the data. If an expert will look at what I have written, he or she will, if that person is expert in cancer, he will understand, no, this cannot occur. This is not a real data. This is just noise. He or she will know that. Because he's an expert, he has understood the data, what should it look like? You know, that we can do. We can learn data. We can learn the density modeling. What data is more likely? What data is not likely? If we have a lot of data, we can train a model to understand, right? What is the real data? What is not data? You can find out if we have a lot of data. That's also unsupervised learning. We are not using label. We are only using the data, right? I hope the example is clear, right? If I take actual data collected from cancer patient and take it to a doctor, because he or she knows what the cancer data looks like, he will understand and he will say, yes, this looks like a data collected from a cancer patient. But if I write some 15 numbers randomly and take it to the doctor, he'll say, no, this is not a this is not a actual data, because he understood the data. So we can train a model to understand the data. How do we train? The likelihood of the data can be maximized. So this is that likelihood of the data. Remember, in supervised, what we're trying to maximize is probability of Y given X, because we know what Y is there for given X. But here we don't know Y. So we want to increase the probability for particular X itself. All right. Right. So there is another question. Let me just quickly attend that. Difference between K nearest neighbor and density modeling. K nearest neighbor is a classifier. Density modeling is not actually a classifier. It's a tool to understand the data. It's an unsupervised thing. K nearest neighbor classifier is a supervised technique where you're assigned a label. You look at given a test sample, you will see what is the K. K can be 5. Let us say 5 training samples that are closer to this. And if all of the 5 belong to a particular category, you assign the same label to the test sample also. That is simple K nearest neighbor classifier, right? That's a supervised technique. Density modeling is not that. Density modeling is basically understanding how data looks. What is data? What is not data? For what sample the probability is higher? So K-means clustering. Okay. So K-means clustering, as you said, given the data, you are finding out the clusters. You will provide a K and find that many clusters. Density modeling is not that. Density modeling here, you see, it's finding out what makes sense as a data, what doesn't make sense as a data, right? If a sample is given to you, the model should be able to say this looks like a data, this is likely to be a data, this is less likely to be a data, things like that. So that is density modeling, understanding how data looks, because you have a lot of access to the data, you can understand what is data, what is not data, right? So you can think of it's also doing understanding, because you are providing a lot of data to it, it will understand what is data. And if something else comes, it will simply say, this is not fitting like data? What I have seen.
Do you mean uncertain data? Pardon? Do you mean that it is on uncertain data?
Correct. So uncertain data, if the probability is less, you can think of it as uncertain data or unlikely data. Yes. Right. So let me go to further slides. It gets a little more clear. Right. The goal is to learn true distribution from which the data is being generated. But this is very challenging, because in most of the physical processes, we don't even have a true distribution. Right. So true distribution means, which is actually sampling the data, from which the data is being sampled. But that is not actually happening. Right. So take the same example, breast cancer data. There need not be an underlying process. So whatever you observe, there may be similarity, but modeling it as a probability distribution and thinking them as samples taken from the distribution is a bit, comfort of the mathematical modeling, but not actually may not be happening. So that way, it is a fishy topic, but as engineers, we go ahead with that, right? So what it means is learning everything about data. As I was saying, looking at the data, you should be able to say whether it is data or not data. Sometimes it is really difficult. So maybe it is not a good idea also, right? It is too much to learn. Learning everything about data, is it a good idea? Or focus only on a task or a simple subset of the challenge, right? General idea is we should focus on things that we believe will be useful. For example, learning everything about the data is not a good idea, because we don't know how to use it. As opposed to that, for example, finding what is useful. For example, in PCA, what we found is we found those components which discriminate the data, which are better to visualize, all those things. Because it is focused, maybe we can use it for applications. So that is where, some philosophical dilemma is also there in researchers, whether it is a good idea to go for and those things that are useful, that we can make applications out of, right? So there are a lot of problems, because it is very hard. So for example, as I was saying, let's go to the same example. Initially, what we started with supervised learning, 1,000 labels contribute to only 12 megabytes, right? But look at the data. Actually, 1.2 million images occupy more than 500 GB of data. If I want to learn all the data, is it possible to learn CNNs or memorize by CNNs? 12 MB easily, these systems can memorize. But actual 1.2 million photographs, which are 500 GB, is it possible? So learning this is very challenging, and is it useful at all? So that is also another philosophical question. So towards the end of the discussion, I wanted to give you some of the open problems, some of the research directions, right? So these are all some of the problems people actively are looking as of now. So density modeling is does a very difficult problem. So this itself will be very clear, right? So what we are attempting is a very challenging problem. The information contained in 1.2 million data is 500 GB, as opposed to labels, corresponding labels is only 12 MB. Supervised learning focuses on the label. That is why the problem is not so challenging. Right. All right, so that way, the better taxonomy maybe is like this. So learning with teacher and without teacher, learning actively or passively, right? Without teacher, there is reinforcement learning. With teacher, there is reinforcement learning and supervised learning. Without teacher, teacher means the target, the label. There is unsupervised learning, there is intrinsic motivation, things like that. So this is a better taxonomy, better classification of learning, machine learning. So there are two accesses. One is with or without using teacher, another is learning actively or passively. So these are a better classification. So people now are trying to look at the learning problems in this direction. All right. So there are a lot of learning without the teacher approaches. For example, you know, I want to give you some self-supervised learning approaches. So there is a lot of image data, right? Lot of image data every day. It been in platforms like, you know, Instagram, Facebook, whatnot. Lot of image sharing applications are there. People upload millions and billions of data, but there is no label for them. Labeling those images is very time consuming and very money consuming also. But there is a lot of data, we can use it for training. So how to create some tasks that can be useful, that can use the data? For example, you know, we can consider tasks like this. This is the input image. I'll rotate it by 90 degrees like this, and I'll try to predict the label as 90 degrees, right? I'll rotate it by 180 degrees, and then for this input, the label is 180 degrees, right? There is no actual label. I myself am creating the labels. The task itself is being generated. The labels here are nothing related to the object that is present. The label here is about understanding the data. This is normal data. If I rotate it, I should predict 90. If I rotate it two times, I should predict it 180, things like that, right? So this is one way to use that label in unsupervised fashion, because we are not actually collecting the labels. We are using the data itself, the structure of the data. This is the canonical form, right? This is 90 degrees rotated, 180 degrees rotated, 270 degrees rotated form. So these are all example unsupervised or self-supervised tasks. For example, this image is there. I'll try to find the relationship between the patches extracted. So for example, this patch, and I'll take this patch. So if I give these two as input, as X, so I'm giving you this patch and this patch as input. The label should be Y. Y is 3. 3 means, what it means is the relation between these two, right? The second patch is diagonally, you know, in the bottom right corner, 2-1. So that is being labeled as 3. Basically, you know, you can think of this as creating labels from the data itself, right? Nobody is generating the label. The system itself is generating the label. So for example, you can ask a jigsaw puzzle. So we can extract the 9 patches and shuffle them and try to recover the original 9 sequence. This also doesn't require human to give the label. Instead, the machine itself can generate the shuffling and labeling also. So there are a lot of such problems. So because the lot of data is there unlabeled in the web, right? All this data that is being generated every minute, because we have the digital revolution happening now. we have smartphones at with everybody, almost everybody, and now we are generating data, right? We want the AI to really learn intelligent systems. So this is all the way. Supervised is very good. If there is enough labor data, things can be learned easily, but it doesn't scale very, very fastly, right? So because of that, we should be able to use unsupervised techniques. We should teach the model to learn the skills, not the tasks actually. So what I mean is, basically, as human beings, we don't do everything supervised. We borrow our skills from doing one task, and we take it, we transfer it to another task, right? We don't do exclusive training for every task. So that is where unsupervised learning has to pitch in the modern AI era, so that, you know, a lot of problems, a lot of intelligent machines can be trained. So we need to get inspiration from there. So this opens up a lot of problems. So yeah, so as a new generation AI engineers, I think we'll be able to focus more on the unsupervised learning along with the supervised. All right, so there are a lot of things like generative models and transfer learning, how to actually take it towards generalizing to other tasks and all that. So these are all open problems. If you are interested, you can try looking for them, try to pursue some interest in this area. All right, sorry if I've taken more time, but this is what I have. Thanks. Thank you.
This conference is no longer being recorded.
Sir, full with a resource person for a day 2 session 11:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. So that is on 8/6/2021 for the topic convolutional neural networks learning and image processing, and day 3, so that is 9/6/2021 for the topic deep generative models and healthcare systems. Dr. Chandra Prakash is currently working as assistant professor in National Institute of Technology, Delhi. So he is a 2010 alumni of Indian Institute of Information Technology and Management, Gwalior, India. So from there, he pursued undergraduates as well as postgraduates, that is BTech and MTech in Information Technology course. And sir has received a PhD degree in Machine Learning from Malaviya National Institute of Technology, Jaipur, India, in 2018. So prior to his NIT Delhi, that is National Institute of Technology Delhi, he served in the Department of Information Technology, Indira Gandhi Technology University, New Delhi. Dr. Prakash has a teaching and research experience over 10 years. And his areas of interest in teaching as well as research Okay, so under teaching, SAR has a vast interest of data structures, design and analysis of algorithms, artificial intelligence and machine learning. And coming to the research areas of interest of our resource persons, so motion analysis, machine learning, deep learning, generative models and reinforcement learning. And SAR has one patent and 37 publications in reputed journals and conferences. And he is a member of various expert committees and board of studies of Government of India bodies. And SAR is a member of editorial committee and a technical program committee of numerous international conferences and journals. And he has organized numerous faculty development programs and workshops for students as well as faculty members in their working place. And he has worked as a developer and a technical consultant for Government of India, Ministry of Law and Justice funded project. And his awards and achievements. SAR has published on the Smart Giant Analysis. So that is, he has one patent. And awarded a best paper in international conference in artificial intelligence and speech technology. So that is in 2019. And SAR has awarded a scholarship as a junior research fellows in a DST funded project. So the topic, the project topic is an robotics assistive biomedical study on effect of posture deviations on elderly and remedies. And SAR has awarded best paper in season in Springer conference. So that is the fifth international conference on soft computing for problem solving and prose in 2015. So the at IIT Roorkee campus. And SAR has a best paper in IEEE conference. So that is the international conference on advances in computer engineering and applications in 2015. And he's awarded as a best paper in IEEE conference in 2014 international conference on soft computing and machine intelligence. And also awarded in elsewhere conference, international conference on computing sciences in 2013. And he's also awarded a scholarship of 2 lakhs as a team for the national level software contest first prize. That is a Lord of the Code 2007-8 in the duration of 7-8. So that is organized by the IIT Bombay and has a consolation of a first prize for this project. Okay, so with this information, so I once again welcome to our resource person, Dr. Chandra Prakash sir, and my dear participants. So be ready for the session and all the best. So, and I thank to everyone for this opportunity. So thank you, sir. Over to the Venkateswar, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible? Okay, let me share my screen. Yes. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me over here. In today's session, we will talk about this CNN in detail. CNN is basically convolutional neural network. Then we will see how we can use this convolutional neural network on image basically. Nowadays it can be applied on the time series data as well, right? So in that, this neural network is there. So we will see what this neural network is. Then we will discuss in detail about CNN. So before this, I would like to show you this video first so that you can aware that what are the applications of AI and how this AI is helpful.
I am an explorer. Searching for the origins of our universe. And charting a safer path to other worlds. I am a helper, moving us forward one step at a time, and giving voice to every emotion. I am a healer, modeling the future of medicine. And finding a needle in a haystack when every second counts. I am a visionary, uncovering masterpieces lost to the ages. And finding new adventures in a galaxy far, far away. I am a builder, driving perfection in everything we create. I am even the narrator of the story you are watching. And the composer of the music. And when the world faces its greatest challenge, give us the power to take it on together. I am AI.
Right, so in this video, you must have seen that what are the different applications of AI? Right, all these application include the image processing as well as the signal processing, NLP. Right, so we will see how we can apply the machine learning models on these different type of applications. So under AI, there are different terminologies. For example, machine learning is there. It's a part of AI to solve a problem. Right, and this deep learning is further a subclassification of machine learning to solve the real-time problem. So machine learning is basically a way to design an algorithm so that it can solve the tedious task or complex pattern task. For example, as you can see in this image, this robot is playing a guitar, right? So this playing a guitar is very tedious and precise work, because you need to know that how much strength you need to, or how much force you need to apply on these strings, otherwise it will break, right? So in machine learning, what we do, we try to learn the pattern from the given data. And this data may be collected from the sensors that are available. Right. So in machine learning, we try to learn, predict, and improve our methodology. Right. So let's see how we recognize the things. Right. So these are the two images. One is of Parliament House, another is of Lord Ganesha. Now, the question is, can you recognize the first image? Is it a picture or a sculpture or portrait, right? If yes, then where it belongs to? Right, so the question is how we recognize these things. The neurons are responsible for learning over here. Now, before we go deep into the neural network on CNN learning, let's see what is the definition of learning. So learning is basically the constructing or modifying the representation of what we experience, right? As you can see in this particular image, that this white cat, it tried to mimic the behavior of the another cat, and based on that the master also feed this white cat. Right, so what we try to do, we try to mimic the behavior and then try to update. Right, so based on the feedback, we can divide the machine learning into three types: supervised, unsupervised, and the reinforcement learning. Today we will talk about the supervised learning, specifically the deep learning in that CNN model. So in supervised learning, the classification and regression part are there. Regression is the term when we have to identify a particular value. If we need to classify a particular problem or object, then we say that it's a problem of classification. In tomorrow's session, we will talk about the unsupervised learning, GAN basically in that, using the deep learning model, where we don't have the label as such, and based on the internal structure, we try to find them some similarity. While in case of reinforcement learning, we try to learn self-learning basically based on some rewards. Right. So in supervised learning, what we try to do, let's say I am having some images with me, and we try to predict a model. The idea of this learning is we try to find a function in such a way so that it can mathematically formulate a formula, so that if you give the input as X, always the output is Y. And based on this, it try to update its weight. Right, so in case of supervised learning, as shown over here, that we are having an example from the car and the motorcycle. So this is the label data. Now, if a new sample is given to you, you need to identify it belongs to group one or group two, car or motorcycle. So we have a lot of supervised learning techniques. Linear regression can be used, the Ciprón, Navis Bayes, neural network, decision tree, SVM. But in real time, we have this issue of not having the data as in the desired format. So the question is how we proceed in that case. So if I want to proceed in this case, I try to find some similar structure. So based on the shape, based on the color, we can divide this data set. And then we can say that this first group or first cluster belongs to round shape objects, right, or square shape objects, and likewise. So in unsupervised learning, we don't have the labeled data with us, and clustering, after applying the clustering approaches, it divided into group A and group B. And whenever a new test sample is given to you, we try to find the similarity of this new test subject with group A or group B. We have the concept of semi-supervised learning, where unlabeled data is there, and then we need to see where a limited data is provided, and then we need to find it belongs to which particular class. In case of reinforcement learning, there's no labeled data, and based on some points, some rewards, the reward may be positive or negative, we try to identify the value, right? So I always take this example whenever I discuss about the reinforcement learning, that riding a bicycle can be an example of this reinforcement learning, right? If your parents, your brother, sister, your friend is with you, or they are helping you, then it's an example of supervised learning. But if there is nobody, you learn by yourself, then we can say it's an example of reinforcement learning. Let's see how. So one day, this kid took the bicycle and he start moving or paddling the bicycle randomly in a random direction. So let's say he start with the left direction, he fell down. So he realized that this particular angle is wrong. So he changes the angle to the, earlier it was 30, now 45, again fell down, changes the angle to 60, again fall down. So he realized that, okay, there may be some issue with this particular side. So let's change the side now. So he try toward the right side with the different angles, again fell down. Now, there was one possibility, or one fine day when he was riding at a 90 degree angle, he was able to ride the bicycle without falling. So in this way, this kid tried to learn from his own experience. Right, so what he tried to do, he tried to build a experience matrix. I called it as a bicycle learning experience matrix. Right, so from a particular state to another state, I need to identify that what reward or what punishment I will get. If I move from left to left, then what is the value? If I move from left to right, then what is the value? If I move from left to straight, then what is the value? Right, so these are the supervised reinforcement learning. Now let's talk about this supervised learning or neural network in detail. Then we will see how this neural network come up with or advanced into the CNN form. So can you tell me what this slide represent? Anyone from the participants? Am I audible or not?
Sir, audible, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay, okay. Yes. Anyone? Because this is how we learn as a human. Yes, any participant? There are two tasks over here. One is that we need to add the numbers. Another is we need to locate the people in this photo, right? So at least tell me how many people are there in this image. Yes?
Seven members, sir. Seven, eight members.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and there's one more over here. right? So total 9. So we can easily recognize these things. But the question is that if I need to add these numbers, can I answer this in the same manner as we identify the people in the image? No. Why? Because as a human, we are good with the pattern recognition, while the computer, I will say that they are good with the numbers. Right. So what we try to do, we try to identify the, or we try to make our computer intelligent enough so that they can also perform the pattern recognition task easily, as we human do, because they are already good with the numbers. Right. So the question was how we interact or how we understand the things. Right. So over here in our brain, the neurons are responsible for learning things. Right. So if somebody asks you that what you had in lunch 2 days back, you will not remember. Right. You might not remember that. But if after eating that particular food, your stomach become upset, then you surely will recognize that after even 1 month, that on that day I ate so and this and this thing, and because of that I was in trouble. Right. So how we recognize that thing? Because that particular activity affect lot of neurons, right? And the information, the larger neuron, or the longer it passes within the neuron, it retain for the longer period. Right. So this second image is actual example or picture of the neurons in our brain. Different creatures had different size of the brain on the neuron. So as a human, I will say that this neuron are responsible for learning, right? Whatever I learn, whatever I remember, all these are because of neuron. And as an engineer, what we try to do, we try to formulate these process mathematically, right? So we see that these are the different neurons. Now let's convert it into some mathematical formula so that we can develop our own artificial neural network or artificial neuron. So what happened, as you can see over here, that in this case each neuron is connected to another neuron, but between them there is a small gap, right? So this gap is basically responsible for your threshold. Maybe possible that you are new to the driving, right? Now initially what happened, that the weights are not trained, we are not experienced enough how to drive a car, let's say. So with a lot of training, then driving a car is very easy, right? How? Because we overcome this threshold, like this gap. Initially this threshold is, let's say, 90%, but with lot of practice, this threshold has become 40% only. So after a lot of practice, what happened, that you learn how to drive a car, right? And you perform lot of operations unknowingly, right? It is as easy as simple walking for you. So as I told you, we need to convert this phenomena of neural network from our brain into mathematical format. So we try to develop the artificial neuron. So for that, what we did, we consider that the dendrites are responsible for the input. We consider them as some input value, x1, x2, xn, right? And then within this particular body cell, we perform some activity, So that activity is basically the summation of all these values. And once we have the summation, so over here, the summation means x1, w1, x2, w2, plus xn, wn, right? Then when we have this summation, and if it is greater than a particular threshold, we say that it will pass the information from one neuron to another. So for that, we use the activation function. Right, so let's say how we learn in a human way. We have some question, we know the answer, then we try to think that how we get that particular answer. Right, I know that this is apple, now I need to form a mathematical model that convert this input into output. Right, so we calculate, we process some thing. So let's say I need to convert this 100 kilometer into miles, and we know that 100 kilometer is equal to 50 miles. Now randomly we will try to formulate the formula, let's say. So miles is equal to meter into some multiplication value, some parameter. So randomly we try random starting parameter, then this one we are considering it is a linear. Then we find that, okay, the correct answer is 62. So we try to find the error so that we can update our error. So it is 12.137. Then we say, okay, let's change the parameter to 0.6. The answer is 62 now, and the error is 2.13. It is better than the previous one, right? Now let's again change. I want as close to the accurate value of 60. So 0.7, now the error is minus 7863. It is worse than the previous one. So we identify that the value should be somewhere in between 0.6 and 0.7, right? So in this way, we keep on trying, and then we see that if I consider the value kilometer into 0.61, then I come close to that value. Error is better. So the question is how we can convert this learning into computer learning, right? So let's see how a machine learning is performed. So we have some input with us, x, y values, some samples. So over here my inputs are length and width, and we are having some classes over here. Two classes are there of the garden bug. One is the ladybird, another is the caterpillar. We are having 7 example of caterpillar and 6 example of ladybird. Now based on this learning, we will try to find a value that can separate these two classes. So we know that how for separation we can use the line equation y equal to mx plus c in simple term. So we need to identify the m and c in that, because we already know y, we already know x. So we keep on changing this line by changing the value of m and c, right? So whenever a new bug is there, if it is above the line, then we say it belongs to class 1, otherwise class 2, right? So classifying the thing is like predicting the values. So for that, we use the training data. And then what we can do, we have to find this line, most optimal line that can segregate this data or separate this data with least error, right? So we can change this line, let's say. So these are the different possible lines, and then we need to see which line is better. Now the question is how we identify that. Again, we take the help of the error, right? So error is basically my target minus the actual value. So E is equal to A plus delta A. X is my input minus actual output, AX. Right, so this delta A is equal to rate of change of error with respect to X. So if you remember the division, then by applying this all over a particular line, we can find the whole value, right? So for this delta A, we take the help of this learning rate also, L into E cross X, so that you can regulate this learning, right? So it should not be very fast, it should not be very low. So the value of learning rate is between 0 to 1. So you need to choose the value of this learning rate wisely. So let's say if I choose the learning rate as 0.5, then we need to see that what are the different, what is the best possible line that it is in. Right, so we choose the best possible line based on some parameter. For example, over here we consider the loss function. Now the different researcher has proposed different methods for the loss function. So we take the help of this error. We individually take the data. We calculate the error corresponding to that data, and then we sum it. And then we say that, okay, my overall error is so and so. Right, so if I am having more than one input, then again, input A, input B, input C with respect to weights, and then output. Then we apply some threshold function. So this threshold, why we use this threshold? So that after crossing that threshold, we can pass the information from one neuron to the next neuron. And another utility of this threshold or activation function is that we can take the cases of non-linearity also, right? So the purpose of the activation function is to introduce the non-linearity into the network, so that if my data is non-linear in nature, right? So let's say if my data is something like this, if this is my X and my O data is this. So earlier we were having a simple line, but now what we need a line like this, right? It is not linear, it is non-linear. So activation function help us to segregate this non-linear data as well. So a neural network without an activation function is just a linear regression model. So as I was talking about that, with the help of linear line, it is not able to segregate, but with the help of non-linear or activation function, we are able to segregate this green data from the red samples. Different type of the activation functions are there. Sigmoid is one of them. Hyperbolic tangent is one of the activation function. ReLU is most properly used in case of the deep neural network. Leaky ReLU. There are different variants of ReLU, but the idea of this slide is to tell you that there are different activation functions that are available, and it depends on the problem area, that which one is better. Right, so as I told you, in single neuron, you are having the, we need to add this A, B, and C, considering the W for all is one, weight. Right, so why we use weight? So that we can say that this input A is of this much weightage. Right, so we can use this single neuron for solving the problem of logical AND or, but XOR cannot be solved using the single neuron. So we need to have, because over here, this is one class, another class is over here. With a single line, we cannot. I need a separate line. So now the idea of the different neurons or multiple neurons was introduced. Right, so multi-layer perceptron was Hello. Yes. So there are two lines with the help of which we can identify the different classes in case of the ZOR. Right. So different neurons were used. So in case of the now let's talk about how we can use this in case of the images. Right. So I am having the input. There was a time when I tried to extract the feature manually, or hand engineered feature, human engineered feature were used. But nowadays, because of the high computational power, we give the whole input as such, right? And then we form one model and then we try to see what is the output. If there is some error, activation function, after applying the activation function, then we say that, okay, this is the loss. So now we need to update the parameters and the architecture. So different problems has different features. For example, for image classification, my picture value, curve, edges are the features. For the cancer detection, the clump thickness, uniformity of the cell size, uniformity of the cell shape, and depending on the type of the cancer, we have different features, right? Same is the example with the cyber attack. So that we, based on those features, we can identify that.
I got a question for you. I got a question for you.
Yes.
On what basis we determine the bias to be applied on the neural network?
We apply the bias on all the neurons except in the input. Why? Because why we use this biasness, right? This is your question, right? Hello?
Yeah, correct. Why we are using bias and on what basis?
Okay, okay. Let me take one example. So let's say you want to come up to the NIT Delhi, right? So from the airport or railway station, you book a cab and you know the distance is, let's say, 30 kilometers. Right, and this is the average speed in Delhi, 40, right? So this is the time I will arrive in NIT Delhi. Now you consider the distance, you consider the map, right? You consider the speed of the cab. So these are the three parameters that you consider, right? Availability of the cab, distance, and the speed, average speed. So these are the three parameters, but maybe possible that there is another parameter, right? The road you selected, right? Because of some construction, it was blocked. So as a human, we cannot consider all the possible inputs or all the possible features. So we always consider another feature. We called it as a bias in simple term, I'm telling you, so that all those cases which we didn't consider in my input can be considered in case of using biasness, right?
Yeah.
So that's why we use this bias.
How do we determine the bias should be this much? Bias should be this much.
Bias value is always one. Input is always considered as one. At the end, what we want to update the weight. In the upcoming slides, I will talk about that in detail.
Okay.
Right. So I was telling you that over here I am having different weights. This is what I need to update throughout my whole training session. Because I know my input, I know my output, right? So if the data is nonlinear, then I divide this data into these two forms, and then I club them together along with some weightage, and then I can say that with the weightage of 1.5, I can divide this data nonlinearly. Right. So let's see how we send this data in forward direction. So A into WA plus B into WB plus C into WC. then we take a threshold function. In case of neural network, this sigmoid is considered as one of the popular threshold function. This sigmoid is 1 upon 1 plus e raised to power minus x, where x is my summation. And then correspondingly, we take the input and we get the output. Now over here, when we got the output, we try to see that what was my desired output. The actual output is the output is 0.7408, while my desired output should be 1, let's say. Right? For example, it should be 1, it should be 0. So we try to find the error then. And mathematically, we convert them into matrix format because that's the simple way. So weight into the input, and we take the simple dot product on that. Now, once we have the error, right? For example, let's say my error over here is 1, right? Now, how much this particular connection has contributed to this error, right? So the weight over here is 3, the weight over here is 1. So definitely it has more weight as compared to this W21, right? So it has more contribution in case of error. So we try to propagate this error in the same proportion. So let's say total error or total weight is 4 over here. So we propagate the error in the same format, 3/4 and 1/4 over here. Right? And then we propagate this error into the hidden layer, then from hidden layer to the input layer likewise. So in this way, again, we calculate the error based on this matrix calculation of weight into the error. So how actually we update the weights, right? So for updating the weight, what we did, we try to find the gradient descent. Because my aim is that I should reach to this global minima. And for that, I need to identify this slope. So it should always decrease. Right. So again, based on your learning rate, the step size may vary. As you can see over here, that the step size is more, that's why it is not reaching to the global minima. It is keep on jumping. So we need to identify that what should be the learning rate efficiently, right? So gradient descent is a way for finding the minimum of the difficult function. So we discussed earlier that the delta A is equal to E divided by W. So, right. So we want to find the slope. So it is delta E divided by delta Wij with respect to Wij. Now, what we want, we using this, we try to find the weight. So this line Y equal to MX plus C, in that the variables or the parameters are my weights. Right. So, and we calculate the error in the same way. Desire minus actual one. So delta E divided by delta W with respect to weight, it is equal to minus of EJ dot actual output, one minus actual output into actual output OI. And how we update the weight? Using the old weight minus the learning rate into the rate of change of error with respect to the weight. This is always negative because in this case, we are always going downward. Right, so let's take an example that, as I told you that we are having these three input, x1, x2, xm. Along with that, we consider another input as bias, as 1, because maybe possible we didn't consider all the values. So we sum all these values. Because my aim over here is to find this value, optimal value of this set W0 to Wm. And we propagate that weight back and then try to update. So let's take an example of a computer, right? So I am having the screen size, hard disk size, processor speed, RAM size, battery time, x1, x2, x3, x4, and x5. Maybe possible that there is another parameter that I forgot. right? So each is having some input, some weightage. Now, in that, if I forget some particular feature, I consider that as a bias. And then the value is B, or WB, you can say. Then correspondingly, I sum all these. I take the transfer function, activation function, and then I get the output. Then I try to find the error, right, using the loss function. For example, over here, the loss function we consider as a mean square error. We propagate back and then update the weights accordingly. Right, we can use the logistic regression as a neural network also, that if the value is greater than, let's say 0.7, my threshold, then I will say that it belongs to class A, otherwise class B. Right, so over here, this cat image, we are considering this value. These are the pixel values. If I am having more than one classes, then this threshold may be of different range. So let's talk about the deep neural network now, or convolution neural network. Right. So why it is possible? Because of the higher computational power, advanced algorithm, and lot of data set available in today's world. One of the data set is ImageNet, right? So in that 22,000 categories are there. And if we compare the efficiency of the deep learning models with respect to the human, right? So the error of the human is around 5%, 5.1%. While in 2017, with the help of the deep neural network, we were able to reach to up to a point which was better, far better than the human prospector, right? So same task was given to human and same task was given to the model, machine learning model. And the error was 2.3 in that, while the error by the human was around 5%. So these are the most pioneer person in the case of the deep learning. So what this deep learning is, how it is different from the traditional machine learning. As I told you that in traditional machine learning, what we used to do, we try to extract the feature by ourselves. And then we use these models and then we identify that if it belongs to class A or class B. So at the end, this human engineered feature right over here play a very important role. Maybe possible that you were able to extract only five features. Then you were able to identify, or your accuracy was 85% in that. If some other student or some other researcher tried to use 10 features, so maybe possible that his accuracy is better than yours, right? So it depends on the number of the features you extract. So it's not the limitation of the classification model, it's the limitation of the features. Or as a human, we extract those features. So the idea of the deep learning was, I'm giving you the input as such, you yourself extract the features and classify it, right? So let's say how this deep learning work. I want to find an image has a human face or not. So as a human, what we know, how we will proceed, we know that human should have two eyes, one nose, one mouth, right, and ears. So on that, the first and the second images are okay. Then we also know that the distance between the eyes should be, so the distance between the eyes and the nose and lips should be this much, right? So this is another feature. So as a human, we will select that this image 2 is of human face. Right, while this even though the image 1 has all the features, but it does not belongs to human. So same case, we try to identify the features using deep learning model. And where we actually use deep learning models, these deep learning models can be used when we are having lot of data with us, right? So in traditional algorithm, SVM, logistic regression, random forest, if I were having a limited data, then it is giving good performance. But if the data is large, then we need to search for some other method, some other model. As you can see over here, right? For very small data, it was giving good result as compared to the deep learning models. So you should see that what amount of the data you are having, what type of the features you need to extract, then accordingly you decide your learning. Right. So in case of the deep neural network, we have multiple hidden layers. All are fully connected. And what we do, we try to extract the features. How we extract the features? Because in this, all the input are given in the form of the pixel, right? These pixel values. So these pixel values, that when we club them, we get the line and the edges, right? So these are the low level features. When we combine these lines and edges, we got the objects, right? For example, ear, eye. This is particularly for the face recognition problem. Same is the case with another image based problems. High level features are when we club all these different objects, right? So the beauty of this method is that all the input are of same nature, pixel values, right? Then at the second level, the edges are there. Then when we combine them, we come up with the objects. When we connect these objects, we come up with the classes, right? Same is the case with the car, elephant, chairs. So we can train on one model and then we can apply it on another also. This is the another advantage. So why are the deep learning methods are helpful in the future? Because if I am having limited input, we cannot find the variations in the input, right? So if I give all the inputs as with the different layers, multiple layers, then even a single hidden layer help capture the different variations in the input. These are the different applications that you must have come across. Face recognition, style transferring, image quality enhancement, beautification, gesture recognition, classification, object detection, right? In computer vision, we not only categorize the data, we also detect the data or the objects. We go with the segmentation. If there are more than one particular person in that, we go with the instance segmentation also. Right, so these are different applications, computer vision, speech and audio, neural, natural language processing. So we can use deep network in detection, prediction, and generation. Today we are talking about the CNN. So for detection and prediction, we can use that. Generation, tomorrow when we will talk about the GAN models, we will see how we can develop a new set of images or the data from the past data. Right, so based on the problem, we have the different models. So you should be aware that what type of the model can be used for which type of the problem, right? What this CNN does, it helps us to understand those features, those input, which we didn't consider at all. Right? For example, this family size, it is a combination of the number of the bedroom and the size of a room. If the size of a room is more, right, so we can consider that there are more number of the people in it, or the family size is more. But with this feature, we didn't give in starting. So the network, what it does, it automatically encode this input data. Now the question is, why actually is computer vision considered as a hard problem in case of the machine learning model? As you have seen the first example, where we need to identify the number of the person in that particular image. Right, so what we are trying to do over here is we see that how the change in the pose, change in the illumination, deformation and occlusion change our approach, right? So as you can see over here, this is a viewpoint variation. By looking at from this particular angle, I cannot say that I cannot identify what this image is, but if I rotate it, I can easily identify. Right, same is the case with the viewpoint variation as we discussed. There are challenges with the background clutters, right? Your image, your object is same as the background image or background color. Different lighting conditions are there. Occlusion problem is there, right? For example, in this case, it is very hard for the machine learning model to identify that there is a cat over here. But as a human, we can identify that easily. So how we can overcome this problem? How we can overcome the problem of the deformation, challenges in the intra-class variation? For example, within the cat itself, there are different type of the colors of the cat. Different type of the